I studied art in a circus. I performed and lived in the circus for 8 years. And then at the same time, I started studying anthropology, and I made a PhD in the United States about the topic of curation. But that's just saying to say that nomadism is something that I experienced, and being a foreigner is something I've been experiencing. Having an identity, of someone who's not from there, and that the people want to stress that you are not from here. So I know that feeling of being a foreigner. So I'll go straight ahead and start with a piece that I did with Fred. As a matter of fact, I started with Lionel, who's here with me, my partner.
Hello,
And Fred and Jacques Bigot, the four of us. But Lionel and I, the first piece we actually did walking is that one that's called Temps d'histoire pour Compostelle. As it says, it's the story of a pilgrimage. So it's not a pilgrimage anymore. It's laïque today. People just go there for diverse reasons. And sociologists say that only hardly 20% go for religious reasons. So we walked and filmed, made interviews, talked and walked at the same time every day, and made performances on the way. And so we edited like 12, 15 interviews of different points of view of the one who walks towards Compostela, and to have a wide range of reasons. And also we interviewed the people who stay on the path, on the who are peasants and settlers, and they talk to the people who pass by. So you have those two movements of looking the movement or going into the landscape with the movement. So it's quite interesting. It could take 2 hours to tell you about this piece, but this situation of moving and capturing image and sound in the movement, it is absolutely interesting. And we made a piece that's called Temps d'histoire pour Compostelle.
Ça a été déjà
It's
posté.
a program that's
Voilà, c'est le
built
terme pour vous.
into
Ça a été
tienda,
déjà
une tente, like a screen, like a tent, And the 380 degrees image involves the people, the public. You can either walk around or sit and manipulate the screen, which is interactive, and you can see from. It's not at all touristic. It's a poetical point of view, and you can either you can absolutely. I mean, you don't have a right to go over to pass stages. You have to go the Spanish comes to me. You have to come. Regularly, literally, linearly. But once you reach a spot, you can study this spot. Thanks to these screens, you choose either nature, which is offered by this screen, foot, or a hand, which hands deliver cultural data. More. So
Sylvie,
according to
can
what
I
you have
interrupt
on
you
the
for a second?
small touch
Sylvie,
screen, you can
Sylvie,
change the scenario and go into details of
Sylvie,
people
can
whom
I
you
interrupt you
meet
for
on
a
the
second?
way or things to see, etc., etc. So that was the first piece that was made over 1,000 kilometers walking. And then we did many other pieces with Fred, including Fred and many other artists. That one was experimental and interesting, Passeur. We equipped a performer with sensors in his feet, in his boots, shoes, and the sound of the steps were sent to a room where installation was taking place, and the installation was the rhythm of the feet.
C'est lui, on voit pas que
gave
on voit pas
its
les
rhythm
images
to the installation. Okay, so that was interesting to do, and it was in the early times of internet. Then the important piece that led me to Mexico is called A Mexica Skin. It's I followed there for 8 months migrants walking through the desert of Arizona and also walking through back and forth from Mexican border to the US and mostly from Mexico to the US. And this big installation, it's 150 mètres carrés, square meters. So this is also a piece made for a public walking, because you have to discover the piece walking around, starting from the south and symbolically passing through a border, you know, made of sheets of towns that you cross. And then you end up in the presumed symbolical north, and you listen step by step to stories told by the migrants that I and we met when we were together. So you kind of actually make a kind of a migration into the installation. And this had led me to discover Mexico. During that time, I met performers. And one of them was starting performing session in Norogachi. I bet you've never heard of Norogachi. Do you know where it's at? It's in the north of Mexico, Sierra Tarahumara, state of Chihuahua. Temps d'histoire pour Compostelle, it's like a big top, you know, a parachute as a matter of fact, on which you have images that are shown on 380 degrees. It's really involving the public. And this is Passeur, you know, this dispositive that makes an installation, the installation is rhythmed by the feet of the people who walk or the performer. So this is A Mexica Skin, which was done during a long walking trip along the border and in Arizona with migrants coming from the south of America towards north. So again, the methodology or the statement, the approach, art approach is the same, is walking and talking and discovering the life, you know, not only interviewing people backstage in a separate place, but living experiences with the people whom you are exchanging with. And to me, the important thing is also to be able to share their life and their ideas and to get into the reality of their experience. But I will briefly go then now to Norogachi, which is in the north of Mexico. And this is where Anton Artaud lived for a month. If everybody knows about Anton Artaud, he was a theater, comment dire, écrivain, writer, and also poet, And we could say that in a way he invented many things. He opened many doors towards sound creation and performance, in between other things. And body to him was very important. He discovered rituals of the Tarahumaras that we are seeing here. And when I arrived in Rogashi, I did not remember that he had been there. I was myself as an anthropologist and artist on the path towards rituals, the root, the ritual roots of arts. And that's why I was there. And that was my first concern. And when I came back to France, I read again this Tarahumara piece by Artaud, and I discovered that I was exactly in the same village he had been into. So I had two searches. I searched Tarahumara rituals on the one hand, among them, you know, of course, peyote, but it's not the only one. There are many, many others. It's rhythm of life. Every month you have special events, every week you have also events, so it's really a cosmic vision of the world, and very interesting to discover. And at the same time, I was looking for traces of Artaud, and I met this old guy who had has recently died. His name is Erasmo Palma. He's himself a poet, and he had met Artaud when he was 8 years old, and he remembered. And of course, I asked him if he knew the works of Artaud, because I discovered there was a real memory of Artaud, a legend of Artaud. People talking about him, where he'd been, and Erasmo himself wrote a poem about him, and showed me the places Antonin Artaud had been, but he had never read about the Tarahumara written by Antonin Artaud. So I thought it was important for him to hear about what Artaud thought about and wrote about Tarahumara. So every time I went, it's a 10 years long piece. It's still going on. I'm still working there. I think I'll never stop working there. It's so rich. But every time to create a piece that's called Continent Rouge, I read Artaud to the Tarahumaras. And I read what the poems and the text he has written about les Tarahumara, and it was interesting for me to get the their point of view. They said that his poems were more more apt or better analyzed their life and translated their life much better than anything that had ever been written by anthropologists. So when I came back, I had this huge corpus of films, sounds, and also poetry by contemporary Tarahumara poets. And the question was, how are we going to translate this piece, like, you know, any other time, you live an experience, how are you going to translate it to the public here? So we did this installation, which shows two sides, the side of the everyday life village, and the side you have to pass through poetry, poems, you know, written by Artaud himself and Tarahumara poets, in order to go into the next steps, which is the ritual area. And at the same time, and this is when Fred introduced me to No Tours Escoita guys, because my question was, how am I going to translate Arto in this piece? And I thought that the best way would be to use sound, because Arto had comment dire enregistré comment on dit déjà enregistré had an interview in a radio, and we have the sound of his voice when he acts as a shaman. So I thought I would use his voice, but where could I put his voice and how could I use his voice? And this is when Fred introduced me to the Escoita group. And here they are. You recognize Horacio. And so together with the installation, we have a sound walk. And I don't know if you can hear the sound, but maybe not. I don't think so. Anyways, so the sound acts on the installation. So we think of the map of the sound walk and try to draw correspondences, relationships between the place. This was in Avignon, for instance, the place where the installation is situated and the topic into the installation. And every step, you know, of the map walked by the public outside the piece have an effect on the installation. So it can start special poems or sounds, you know, according to the place you are in. It was very interesting to work this piece. It is still we are showing it. It has been shown a long time in a very big museum in Mexico, Amparo, and also it has been shown recently in Lascaux in France for 6 months. So it's a piece it's little success, and I think it deserves it. Now I work with women, Tarahumara women, about their dances and writings and special poems and culture. So I organized a meeting 2 years ago around their talks, and the important thing for me at that time was to record, help them use their telephones to record the stories they remember, to record the stories or poems they write, and also to feed from things they exchange together. So this also I've been working with Horacio in the beginning, and the University of Mexico, who started a collection of sounds from, and I'm still working with them. Tomorrow I'll do an interview. I mean, the material is so interesting and so important, because what these people know, we don't, and we should know and we should learn more from them according to, of course, to the way we live into nature and so, and cosmos and so on and so forth. And then at the same time, you know, this is now, it has been work starting recently. Here arrived, as you see, I haven't shown you all the pieces I've done. It's too long. But also with Lionel, we worked in Mongolia and also United States and lots of places in Europe, blah, blah, blah. But 3 years ago, a center for refugees opened in the village. And we have now the whole world, we could say, represented by those young guys coming to us. And one of the first steps that we make together is walking, because when they arrived and when they still arrive, because some go, some arrive, we don't speak the same languages at all. Not at all. I can tell you, we had this topic yesterday with Yogurt. Not everybody speaks English. We think that everybody speaks English, but no, not at all. These guys, if they have they speak five languages each, but the tongue that they share is, for instance, Arabic. They speak languages talked by maybe a few millions, and sometimes not even 1 million people, but their intercourse language is Arabic. And for those who come from Afghanistan and from India, they speak Tibet as well. So they speak main Indian language, like Hindi, Urdu, etc. So this I knew, you know, that I was not at the center of the world, and I know that I did this job of an artist. I'm an artist because I want to know more about the world. But definitely this project, which is called Hospitalité en Action, proved to me that Occidental people is not at the center and no more in charge in ruling the world at all. And these guys, they come with knowledge, it's incredible, with languages. And so we really exchange, you know, their music, their language, their graphism, their alphabets. And it's really a pleasure. So since COVID, we can't walk as much as we could before, only six at a time. Sometimes we used to walk, you know, go out walking and then come back to the studio and work. Now only five, six can walk and then come back or not to the studio and work online. This is what we do now. But we keep working intensively. After 3 years, we have also an enormous corpus of sounds coming from everywhere, and text. And I was thinking, I wrote during the last confinement, I wrote this piece, Asmarie. Asmarie means, it's like bard or troubadour. What would that be in English? Do you understand troubadour? Troubadour.
Yes.
Oui. Okay. So it's very good. So it's people who tell stories about the past and who tell the stories of contemporary life, of their contemporary life. And so this is Asmarie written en lettres romaines, and also Dimwetsi, c'est un autre, another way of saying singer and poet. So this is what the piece is called. The idea being to collect, to have a piece, a place for exchanging text, oral text, written text, and sounds. Also a place where we could jam together. And this is what we did last night, for instance. Almost every week, we organize live concerts. Fred will talk more about it. And so these, the four chapters that we are building in this project is gathering text, oral and written, making live performance together, and quoi d'autre? j'oublie les autres. Installation also. It's also an installation because they design things and well, visually very beautiful, and also soundscape, sound walks. So this, and now I will let Fred present the web app, CGOMAP Asmarie.
All right, so I will not explain so well as Sylvie could do the project. I could explain the project more on the side of a locative media experiment and how we can use geolocation and mapping and cartography to expand the Asmarie project with the idea to, at the end, expand around the imaginary and also the physicality of the crow, the crow, which is the music instrument, very important for the musicians. And so what we wanted to do is a kind of expansion of the crow with some electronic channels, let's say, some digital channel, making a kind of meta crow, we would say. So we had different targets, we have different desires. One of them was to use geolocation to create sound walks on the mobile phone. But also we wanted to use the CGOMAP platform to create other channels. So more than thinking about categories on a map, it's really about different channels to explore different kind of collaborative creativity with the artists, with the musicians. It's very important that all the process is a collaborative process. So it's we are just starting this project. For example, on the map, we have some icons like the radio channel. Then we will explore with Eritrean musicians and other musicians from Africa, how they can expand their music in the public space by doing sound walks. But it's a little bit early. For the moment, we are experimenting. On Saturday, we are experimenting the idea of creating a slideshow, a selection of images with the artist. I can show some entries.
Which was also the scenography, the background for the live concert.
Yeah, so I can show you, for example, some images of the live concert. Then we have a channel for the live concert with CGOMAP, which is called CRAR Live, where we publish images and sounds, a memory of this concert. So, for example, I could, as you can see, you know, on the computer, we can show these images as a slideshow. This is a crowd instrument. Yeah. And you can see that behind the musician, we have a video projection or several video projections and also a projection of images. And what we did with them is searching on internet for images to try to illustrate their songs. So we were searching for images from Eritrea. Oui. And during 2 or 3 days, we were collaborating with them to select the images they wanted to show during the concert. So yeah, so that's a little bit this idea. This is the channel, which is a CRAR book. It's where we put this kind of content, images, sounds, text, creating this digital book. And yeah, so we explore this different channel with mobile technology. I just show you on the computer, but also it's also accessible from the mobile phone. And we explore different way to use this technology for video projection, for projection during the concert, or for walking working cells. Yeah, that's it, more or less.
Next time they come this week, you can join. We have a concert this time with people from Guinea, with this group from Eritrea. Will have another workshop in mid July, and we'll this time project words written in their different alphabet. So every time we advance step by step, and the work increases, and we never do anything alone. It's always they tell us what they want to do, and they learn at the same time. It's really a lot of fun. Viens Lionel. I would like Lionel to join me because he's doing this piece, and he's put his beautiful red shirt, which suits your background. So it would be too bad for him to stay in the dark room. T'as un très beau fond de rouge là. Voilà. Je sais pas où c'est.
Rouge sur rouge.
Okay.
Thank you, Sylvie. Except if you would have anything to add, I would propose to talk a bit about all this richness, this rich menu of the wonderful dishes you served us, and what I what you told me yesterday about the walking methodology, that for you walking is like in fluidity and a fluid space in which dialogue can emerge.
Oui.
So
oui.
That actually the meeting with people happens simultaneously and parallelly with an immersion in nature, because it creates an open space of dialogue and interaction. And that actually every project you do is an outdoors project, even if it is a project that is eventually presented indoors. This is really inspiring to see walking arts not only in the perspective of a moving body in
yes.
outside, because well, as a methodology, as a dialogue, constant dialogue with where we are. And,
it would be for me l'art de la rencontre. L'art de la rencontre. You know, I've never thought about being. I just discovered a walking artist. You know, art is just walking for me has been and remains a tool, because it's the movement of life. I mean, it's basic, you know, to human beings, and from going to one place to the other in my room, but also to other countries migrating, we've always been able to survive thanks to migration. We have human beings have been migrating, so I think it's art of the movement and art of art de la rencontre, of meeting. To me, that's what is important, and to grow up, you know, it's very inspiring. So yes, we are traveling a lot. We've been traveling a lot elsewhere, and we've been so lucky to be locked in just after this center was opened, this center for refugees, because we are inside this world together. And here we are in 1 kilometer large territory, talking how many? 50 languages. It's amazing. And having the luck to know things I've had never heard of, never. And of ethnies, of a group, ethnic groups, alphabets, names of even plants, you know. It's so rich, So I'm so sorry they have to go to such ordeals to come here, because if I start speaking about comment dire, European laws towards people coming in searching refuge from wars and hungry, being hungry, it's terrible. But for us, and also I think for them in a way, when we are put together with so many differences, but at the same time so human all together, it's so rich, it's such a big luck. And I wish European people were more aware of this richness that's coming in, you know, of knowledge, of sounds, of for artists, it's amazing. So for now 2 years, I've been inviting artists to like Occidental people who have been living here for a long time to take part in the workshops, but they are not like, you know, giving class, they are learning from the guys who come working with us, and we are learning together. And it's, for me, it's becoming an experimental platform for artists to learn about other languages and other areas in their art. And all the artists who've been coming here for 2 years, I mean, artists who've been living in Europe for a long time, they fell in love with this project, and they keep coming, and we are, you know, growing a humane, je sais pas quoi, links, bonds, and also something specific, artistically speaking, something, comment dire, which never existed before. It's un mélange extraordinaire. So, I mean, it's so pleasurable, first of all. Non?
Yes.
No. Voilà, well, je ne sais pas quoi vous dire.
Yes. What is striking me as well is, and we have other people here that are in the same situation, is how incredible things are happening in the smallest places. Yeah, Sylvie, you're living in a very small village. Fred is living, I think, in an even smaller village. Then the Claudia and Clara, they are also working from very small places. And Rika, you remember the Prespes, where we had our wonderful project, is also it's a dot on the map, and still it sort of gets an outreach that is going much beyond, that is becoming global, that is reaching out to the world. And
Well, it's also in cities, you know. There are camps, and our first experience in Europe, because we had this experience walking on the border, Mexican border, but here in Europe is the jungle, la jungle de Calais. In Calais, it was a city. It was Babel. It was, you've heard about the jungle of Calais, of course. Oui.
Mm-hmm.
Oui. It was in a way une utopie, utopia, because everybody was, well, some people, most people were trying to help each other and building new incredible architectures with nothing, with just tar, with wood, you know, carton. But some new shapes, new. I think the police destroyed this place because there was such comment dire, energy, creative energy, qui était dérangeante, subversive thinking. People, you know, deciding, making things, organizing differently, and a different political system was being put up. And that's also why maybe refugees are not very welcome. But I'm not politic, you know, in this. Yes, of course. I mean, as an artist, your position is political. Yes, but away from political parties. But I don't know what to tell you exactly. C'est pas. Yeah, we're not into a militant thing. We are really. I think it is subversive probably, but just because it's beautiful. It's just beautiful. It's just beauty and just simple. It's so simple. You just open your door. Okay, this is my name, this is your name. What would you like? You don't like this? We have this and this, we do this together. Je sais pas, c'est quelque chose de magique. And so easy to do. Moi, je ne sais pas quoi dire de plus. Voilà, voilà.
Can I ask a question? You mentioned Troubadour and you mentioned Artaud. Can I ask you a couple of questions? In relation to Troubadour, the three great periods in music, the centuries, were the 13th century when Troubadour music, particularly in France, was very, very strong. And you've maintained that Troubadour tradition right from the 13th century. Now, Artaud, I know, only in connection with the Theatre of Cruelty.
Oui, bien sûr.
Is there any connection with his poetry? No, okay.
Not at all.
No.
You mean between Artaud and Troubadour? No.
No. Between he had. I associate the Theatre of Cruelty.
Oh yes.
The Theatre of Cruelty with Artaud. A separate question. There's the Troubadour one, and the other side. The other question was about Artaud and the Theatre of Cruelty. How does this play into his poetry and possibly his vision of the world?
Well, I think he was very impressed by the Tarahumara rituals, which still are going on. We just finished a film about this strength of the rituals, and it's something that you embody as a group. And je suis pas spécialiste en Artaud du tout hein, sur le théâtre de la cruauté. But Artaud was, from what I know of his relationship with Les Tarahumara, it's something that really opened the door for him to create something where you don't play a role. Theater is no longer to play a role, you know, or to read a text, but is to experience an act, embody an idea, and you are away from representation. And he discovered
Sorry.
That with the first with Cambodge, he had the slight idea with the Cambodge dancers that he saw in Marseille, and then it was an intuition,
wow.
And this intuition was. This intuition was, confirmed when he arrived in the Sierra Tarahumara and met Tarahumara people, who are still
oui.
Doing the same acts today. That's what was interesting for me, because I'm not a specialist of Artaud, but when I reread Artaud after having met the Tarahumaras, and I noticed that what they did, they still do today. And if they are growing instead of disappearing, it's also due to this maybe cruelty. You know, this it's not cruelty in the sense of je crois pas, hein, je me souviens plus bien.
Mais c'est une sorte de mort, le rituel du peyote.
Mais je sais pas si c'était dû au peyote, tu crois?
Non, mais le rituel lui-même, c'est une sorte de mort et de renaissance au
oui.
Matin. Ça revient souvent dans le.
Oui.
Et il a écrit, il a fini d'écrire le théâtre et son double sur le bateau en allant,
au Mexique.
En partant au Mexique. Dis-le en anglais.
Rousseau, he was writing le théâtre et son double, theater and its double, and it's really about l'incarnation, what I was talking to you about, representation. quitting for him, theater should not be playing, but it should be being. I'm not a specialist of Artaud, but he wrote that idea going towards Mexico, and then coming back from Mexico after he had the experience, like he had this intuition, and his theory was confirmed by his experience with Tavamarit.
That's interesting, because I studied with Lee Strasberg, and he was very dismissive of Artaud, because he said he was just the theory, and he applied, whereas Lee Strasberg was actually living the part, where he said, you know, Jerzy Grotowski in Poland and Artaud were based on theory rather than something that was actually physiognomically happening to you. But thank you for that.
No, but I'm not at all a specialist of Artaud. I met Artaud in the Sierra Tarahumara, and I understood Artaud thanks to the Tarahumaras, who helped me understand his art. Before, I had read, but I have to admit that some parts were really easy to understand for me, some not. But being in this strange, I mean, you know, it's a specific landscape, la Sierra Tarahumara. It's a specific landscape. It has an impact on your thought. And well, I can share a link with you, Gert. I can send you a link to the very latest film we just finished a few weeks ago about the Tarahumara rituals, contemporary Tarahumara rituals. So you'll get to know a little bit, because Artaud has constantly been working and thinking and writing with the Tarahumaras in his experience, in his body, ever since he met them. His very last poem he wrote, it's called Tutuguri. He wrote it 2 weeks before dying. It's mm-hmm. to say that this meeting with Tarahumara is something real. Tarahumara, I am with, comment dire, avec la pensée autochtone. It's we were talking about Occidental culture, but Tarahumara and lots of other ethnic groups in the world have this specific autochthonous thought, which is linked to the earth and cosmos. Wow. But I'm not good at talking about, I'm not, but you see what I mean. It's some other, c'est un peu, comment dire, blabla tout ce que je dis. C'est un peu superficiel ce que je dis. C'est pas grave. Okay, so if you have well, I'm sorry.
Can I put forward a few questions as well?
Oui, bien sûr.
Merci. The first is a very practical one. It's related to the work as you documented on your CGO map. And that is, what is for you the added value of the locative aspect of CGO map for the documentation process of the events that happen in your village?
Well, it's just a little part. The main part is what happens here with the people in the village. Locative media is just to share an experience. You know, it's a door. Let's say it's a door. I would say it's a door. It's not the main thing. It's just opening and giving you some hints, you know, for knowing more and being able to meet. I think it's just a door. It's just
so like more like an entry point into the work, if you will. Okay, thanks. Now then, a question that's maybe a little bit more complex to answer. You talk about all the learnings that you and the people that you meet experience, that you, the people from the village and the people who visit the village, that everyone learns from each other. So that means that the collection of knowledge grows where you are, which is great. Now, how do all these experiences inform life back in, let's say, Eritrea, where several of the refugees are from? Is there also a flow of knowledge that goes back to Eritrea or any of the other places where the refugees are from?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Thank you for asking it. As you know, it's I think one of the most terrible dictatorship, and it's impossible for them to go back. It's impossible for them to go back because they came from death. Most of them experienced, you know, near-death experiences. They know of death. I can see it in their eyes. I can feel it in their songs, in their silences, in the way they look at the water flow, in the way they walk into the grass, you know, when they in the spring. They really had a close touch with death. They saw death, they saw people dying. They rescue. So it's absolutely, this is the terrible thing of exile, is that you can't go back. And you flee, you don't go to, you flee from. It's not the same movement. When you go for une petite promenade dans la campagne, okay, you go to pick up flowers, but they don't go to anything. They flee from death. You have to understand it's not the same movement. You flee from death, so you go towards life. We could say also to be binary. But the beauty of it is that they are alive, and they had a close touch with death. They are alive, and they want to live. Even though they had this, you know, threat of death. But as going back to, no, nothing but death is. Death is nothing but, no, it's c'est impensable ce qui se passe dans ce pays-là. But so that all the youth are, the youth is abroad. It's one of the most, the broadest, comment on appelle ça, people in the tout le monde est parti, everybody has left, comment on appelle ça, il y a un mot,
un exode,
c'est pas exact, c'est l'autre, but anyways, so they are in several countries of the world, everywhere, all the countries of the world. You have Eritreans.
I would like to comment about the interest of using locative resources, because I believe that these people, these artists, musicians are delocated. They are out of their country, and so it's very interesting if we can help them to reroute in the country where they are now. And then this idea to locate, geolocate songs or music or poetry is a way for them to relocate themselves in the territory where they are. I think it's an important
aspect. That's a very good point. You know? It's sort of like a way to provide a method for grounding themselves again, is what you're saying.
Yes, absolutely.
That's very interesting, I think. So it's more like therapy. very interesting.
Not exactly. It's a language, creative language rooted into the earth, and a way to understand that we are all on earth, and where they are now is also their territory.
Mm-hmm.
They also can belong to this place.
Yes, and also at the same time, it was very funny to when we told them that we could geolocalize their songs in Eritrea on the Google Maps. So it gives us also, it's the only way they can be free to go to Eritrea is through Google Earth. It's
virtually, yeah. But is this your plan as well with the application that you are building? Because currently the locations that are marked on the map are only in France. There is nothing yet in Eritrea. Mm-hmm. So are you planning on mixing this up?
No. Yeah, but it would be their decision. Not ours, but yes, mm-hmm. it's totally possible. If they have the desire to offer or geolocate a song for their family on top of their village, they can do it. And we would love to see this happening. I think it would be interesting, really very beautiful. But we don't know. We will see if this happens, but it can happen, I think so, yeah.
And
but Fred, this is an answer to my first question, but not to my second question as to what of this knowledge that people gain flows back into Eritrea. It doesn't have to be directly via the individuals that actually take in this knowledge because they are refugees and might have a very hard time to return, but they have families, they have friends, they have networks through which maybe some of this knowledge could flow back.
Yeah, but this is a conversation we have to have with the artists and musicians, and we will discover ways. It can happen, but I don't know yet, because we should not take the decisions for them. It has to be really a
collaborative process. No, that's very true. It's not your decision to make. That's very true.
I think so, Sylvie, right?
Yeah,
I think it's important.
I was looking for the word diaspora. They are all over the world. And they use a lot. The reason I was interested in using and working with Fred and using telephone is that their main tool is telephone. They don't have a laptop, as you know, because I would have loved to share this talk with them, but they don't have laptops. There is no internet in their country, in Eritrea. But the only tool they have is this one. So it's their tool. That's why we are circling around their tool. They're also using their application, their images, their way of exchanging images. So that's very important. It's not like a violinist, you know, who will play a beautiful beautifully and then he will teach them how to. No, it's there more than mine. There's it's yours too, I mean, but it's very important to share the same tool and to invent, create something together with this tool, because it's really a multimedia tool. I mean, you all know what a smartphone can do, and so we can write, we can do everything. So it's just a matter of, comment dire, c'est plus un processus, c'est aussi un processus, plus que, qu'un but.
You seem to have lost Sylvie.
Oh no.
The Eritrean government has arrived.
Yes. Would you like to add something to that, Fred, to the power of a smartphone to reconnect us?
I say quite a lot already. I'm very excited by this project, and yes, they use this mobile phone every day, but they are not very aware of the possibilities and the significance of geolocating their songs, for example. And what does that mean for them to be creative and invite people to discover songs in locations? That's something we will discover with them soon, but not yet. It's really a very slow process.
Can I ask
that's
you a
very
question?
Interesting.
Can I ask you a question? We're seeing a world that's still dominated by Eurocentric culture. Now, someone like Fela Kuti in Nigeria was beginning, but then he was killed in his mission to actually put his own culture in. I don't think we've seen it anywhere in the world, but what you're talking about is the beginnings of this. the beginnings of other cultures dominating Eurocentric views and changing the balance of world culture in a sense?
We have so much to learn, you know, because there is so much wisdom we have lost. And it's still in other ethnics, other continents and other countries. And yes, I believe there is a huge desire to reconnect with what we have lost, of course.
Any idea how to do this?
Oh, Sylvie's and Lionel's artwork is a good example. Working, meeting people, opening your door, discovering other cultures, other languages. That's a way.
If I may respond as well to this, Bob, I'm not convinced at all that there is a shift happening in what the center of the world is in these last few decades. If anything, maybe it will move to China, but it will not move anywhere else for the simple reason that economics dictate the culture globally in a neoliberal post-capitalist society. Sad but true.
It's sad. I agree with you. Here. Very sad.
Yeah. And I think you see this as well. Welcome back, Sylvie.
Merci.
In a way, in Sylvie's project, first of all, these creators, they are here, or they're in France. I'm going to say here. They're in France. They have a hard time communicating back to Eritrea. They use technology that is developed in California and manufactured in China.
Amen.
There is no shift to the south. There is only a penetration in the north.
And they get submerged and labeled subversive. And that's the thanks we give them.
Yeah. I have one more question for you, Sylvie, if I may. And that is, early on, you mentioned that you have a lot of experience as a nomad, in part also because you worked in the circus for 8 years. And you also have, you said that you worked in Mongolia. And if there's one thing Mongolia is known for, is its nomadism. Even though half the country lives in Ulaanbaatar, the other half still lives in a country that is the size of Western Europe and then some, and most of these people move around. So can you maybe say a few things about your experience there and what you did and, well, what your learnings were maybe?
Oh, well, it would be a specific talk. We did a piece there with Mongol people. What I learned is what I've been always searching is other visions of the world, and I was je t'ai servi. Je veux dire, I had a gift because they don't. For instance, we, when you look at a map, we look the map. You're okay with me. North is up and south is down, and then you have west on your left and right and east and the right. When you look at a map, you see that, okay? Okay? Oui?
Oui.
Okay, bon. So, but they, comment dire, they,
look at or,
they, all right, they orient themselves from the south. The south is the specific point from which they organize their space. So they open, for instance, their yurt towards the south, which is the most lit place during the day. And you enter by the south, always, always, always. And so when you enter the yurt, you go left towards, which is left, because for them, the word south means also the word in front of my body, and the word back means also behind my body. So they don't have a sense of comme nous, espace different from time, but it's a space-time reality. And then south and in front is the same word, and backwards is also part of my body. And they are in, ils se sont, ils incarnent, ils s'incarnent dans l'espace-temps. Ça c'est difficile à traduire, mais Gert, tu pourrais peut-être m'aider. They embody themselves in space-time. They include their body with the one of the others around them in space and time at the same time. So when you, quand tu as le sud as a specific comment, repère, you, the main state is south, then when you look at south, on your right, you have west, and on your left, you have left. So to them, left is the same word as east, and west is the same word as west. I'm sorry, my English is terrible. So do you understand what I mean?
Gauche.
Droite, c'est l'ouest, et gauche, c'est l'est. So what I mean is they don't separate space from time. They don't exclude, extract their body from space and time. You know, they think of themselves in space and time, and it's very different. Also starting as a real state, comme un point de repère juste et exact, for them is south instead of us north. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah,
I think so.
Levi Strauss wrote about this a lot, and anthropology in a philosophical sense, it's ever so complex, but yeah, got it.
But it means that it's opposite of how I behave, you know, how I was grown up. And so we made an installation starting from this reality. And we made a round installation. Well, that Fred worked with us on that too, with a round centered spot, which was interactive and different rhythms. But it, to tell you that from just this different point of view, because it's a point of view, if you organize your world from north, or if you organize your world from south and from your body and space-time, you build up a different world. At the same time, they are still human. It's human, of course. But it's interesting to plonger dans des réalités si
universelles.
Oui, lointaines et universelles, si tu veux. Mais c'est intéressant quand même de make a shift, you know, in your head. Just make a shift. Fais un pas de côté. Et tu vois le monde différemment après. So all these experiences, also 8 years in a real circus, you know, then I was the foreigner, I was the gypsy, you know, the one who should be I was the bad one, just because I was living in a caravan. Also, this is an experience I think that built me up. It built me up as a woman, to be stronger, and it's built me up as a human being to be stronger also against racism. Parce que quand t'es nomade, nomads are very often not liked by sedentaries, settled one.
Yeah, just look at gypsies in Europe. Yeah.
Well,
south of France.
I'm not so thanks for that. I'm not so familiar with the positioning of Mongolians of themselves in space, but time I'm a little bit more familiar with, and that's also one thing that I always found fascinating, but also something that I've very often seen in many particularly sub-Saharan African cultures, although I don't want to generalize, but we only have an hour and a half. And that is that time is not like for us a commodity, something that you can lose by just not, if you don't do anything, that's totally fine. If you don't really agree to meet at a particular time and date, you maybe agree to meet, and it can be today or tomorrow or the day after, And whenever you meet is the right time to meet. So indeed, a very different concept of time.
Yeah, I know, but I'm comment dire, je me méfie. I don't trust too much this, because the people say that about is about autochthonous in Canada, you know, toute l'Amérique indienne. Also, they say that of Mexicans, and they say, oh, you know, for them, time is flexible, where us, you know, we are white and we are well organized, and time is time. Well, it's another. Yeah, you're right in a way. It's maybe another. They have different criteria, and I'll tell you what the criteria are. Some of them is that they want to have consensus, because. Yes. Sometimes they have to get sure to make sure that everybody is ready for it. So it's not I decide that it will be at 2 o'clock, but it's, you know, we have to make sure everybody is set, and there are some flows, and okay, now the right time because everybody is here. They have from what I learned in the Tarahumara. Is they have a lot of collective talk, more than we do maybe, and make sure that that can be done, the group is more important than the individual. Maybe it's one of the rational explanation I could give, but they are also very efficient. Maybe not exactly the way we are. Je sais pas, t'as quelque chose à dire là-dessus? Mais je me méfie un petit peu des. Okay. I have a question, my dear Babak, for you. What's the name of your cat? And
kind of... he is now sitting on the chair behind me. There he is.
And what kind of cat is
this? Well, it's a street cat. He's not a street cat. He lives in our house, but we call him Patrick or Mr. P.
Ah, d'accord. He has wonderful eyes, his incredible eyes. I mean, he was...
It's very interesting that you notice this. His eyes, he's got a disease. What disease? A bug? Exactly. No, a parasite. And it's called Florida spots. And it's something that was discovered by doctors in Florida. And it's something that cats, but not dogs typically, can get in tropical climates. It clouds up their eyes.
From here.
It makes them look metaphysical. And we have another cat, and normally that cat sleeps on the stereo that you now see in the corner of my little video, but she's not here. And she also has the same eyes, so they both maybe see between worlds, maybe.
Fais attention à pas l'attraper. Be cautious, you don't get it.
Humans can't get it. And it's also not even infectious. That is, one cat cannot give it to another. It's something that comes from the environment. It looks a bit scary sometimes, but at the same time, it's very endearing.
I would like to say something to Fred. C'est toujours là, Fred? Ah oui.
Toujours là.
Bien sûr. Oui, it's an immense pleasure to work with Fred again. Because we've been working together for 55 years, I think. It's amazing.
Yes, it's a life story.
Wait. It's intéressant, and it's really a pleasure. I'm always amazed of the vivacité de Fred, how fast he gets it, and how wonderfully he translates it into a political way. And I feel so lucky
It's because I have very good mentors.
Very good what?
Mentors.
Des bons mentors.
Teachers.
Alors là, je ne sais pas, I don't know who you refer to. But, yeah, it's really a pleasure. We have a lot of fun. I think this piece you were asking, Babak, it's not a piece. I missed, you know, this part. My computer went off. But I think it's vraiment un processus de rencontre. It's just, you know, to work, to play around together. Ça fait pas très universitaire de dire ça, mais c'est vrai, on s'amuse bien en fait. Et voilà.
Indeed.
C'est tout.
Friendship has its own time and space, absolutely. So,
yeah. Yeah, I wish I met you all in reality sometime. Gert, you have to come over.
Mm-hmm. That actually, the talking about time and space, in Brazil, you have the, let's say, the concept of desencontro, as Babak will know, which presupposes that you actually can meet each other without actually meeting each other. But it is meeting each other by being at the same place, but at a different time. So, which is a very beautiful concept as well. So you don't have to meet each other physically, but meet each other and want to be together. And I think this, what you tell us, shows this so intensely and beautifully. We are going slowly towards 9:30. I'm talking again
yes.
about time. So if anybody has a question, a feedback, something he would like to share, I would like to, maybe we can do this now and slowly move towards closing the session with some final questions or question.
Can I ask them?
Hmm? Yes.
I was fascinated about the work with the Eritrean musicians, and I was just wanting to know whether, are they all musicians or are they all, you know, is this something, and also how many are there, and how is the reception in the community?
They are professional musicians. We first met one and made friends, and then he had to flee away because of laws. We couldn't stay in France. Then he came back. He could come back. I mean, the law permitted him again. And he went to Nantes, and he introduced us to other musicians. And when we met him, it was one of the first meeting we did here. So we walked, then came back. Like every day, like every time we do meetings, and that time we sang. We don't sing at every time, but that was the very first time we were singing. You know, we draw a circle and everybody sings the one after the others. And that one, I mean, you can see that he's a singer. So I asked him, how comes and what's your instrument? And he says, kra. And I had never heard of that instrument. I had never heard of it. So he draws me little things like that. And I go to the internet, I see, kra, okay. And I think, it's $350. And at that time, we didn't have $350. So I thought, maybe we can draw a collaboration with Maison du Patrimoine. They have a professional wood maker. And I phoned at this. I said, could you make a krar? What's a krar? It's a lyre. Okay, come on, come over. And we did one krar, two krar, trois krar, quatre krar. And so this guy, he recovered the whole range, you know, strengths of his art. thanks to this first car, which was not very well done at the time, but he could still play. And these instruments are very interesting because you can make it out of, you know, very easily out of wood. They are, I think, into the nomadic thinking because they are light, easy to carry along, and also easy to make up. You know, it's very, comment dire, shareable. It's not like la vielle de gambe avec 36 cordes et puis 36 machins, des trucs de lourd bourgeois. Là, non, c'est vraiment, c'est un petit English. Instrument léger. It's a little light instrument that's easy made. And so he grew up, you know, in his art. He recovered. He had been in a prison for 5 years. And then made a slave after that in Libya for a year and a half. So he had not been playing the krar for 6 years or more. So he recovered. And I mean, on the day when we finished the first krar, he took the krar and he played the krar like if he had never stopped. C'est vrai, hein? He has never forgotten, like, tu fais de la bicyclette, tu montes sur ton vélo, et il a repris son krar, il a rejoué du krar. But he's becoming better and better. He's excellent musician. And then he met more in Germany, so introduced me to more. So now I have like six musicians around. And
It's fascinating. It's really amazing. Is it mainly you're making, or you think you were just lucky to meet them like that?
I think what?
Do you think it's mainly your making and your, you know, your ability to bring people together, or is it just lucky that you met them there?
I think it's both, because if you are just to meet them and you don't do anything, that it doesn't go any further.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
I want to hear the singing.
Yeah, but come on. I can share some. I will send you two, three links of songs by them.
That would be interesting, yes.
D'accord. So, you have to love life. That's all.
Mm-hmm.
It's easy. If you love life, comment?
We have some songs on the crowdfund.
Oui, c'est vrai. Oui. If you love life, you just go with life. You know, you don't stop, because Well, yes, of course. I push life. When I feel life, I flow into life easily, more easily than many people, more easily than maybe some people. That's true, I admit it. And I went, when I see an opportunity, not opportunity, a sign, I feel a sign of life, I just, je décolle. Ben voilà. Ben merci beaucoup.
Merci.
It's 9:33 p.m. It was nice. I'm sorry I missed this presentation from the very start, but I'm glad to have met you, and I hope we'll meet again. Come over.
Au revoir.